In this video, I'm going to show the image of why we need a Decision Feedback Equalizer DFE in the 30 system. Before why, what's the Decision Feedback Equalizer? Perhaps we can start the equalizer category of a DFE. From the why CTOE video, you may know the difference between the discrete time and continuous time equalizer. But this time, you could be surprised that the DFE is a discrete time equalizer, and we prefer using it even though we said that the discrete time equalizer would have more design overhead and challenge. Think about the image of why the discrete time DFE may not have the concern we discussed before in the why CTOE videos for 5 seconds. Correct. The proper placement is the key. Last time, we tried to put the CTOE at the front end, which is right after a channel that is. Since the clock feed-through from the discrete time equalizer could be a concern to interfere with the input signal of the RX front end, and some reflection kicking back to the RX. On the other hand, if the discrete time DFE was placed after the CTOE, the clock feed-through to the RX front end can be minimized. Another advantage of putting the CTOE at the front end is that the RX front end signal's dynamic range can be reduced. All the swing difference can be equalized well. Owing to the reduced dynamic range, then either the sampling accuracy can be increased, or the clock jitter power requirement can be relaxed. Next surprising image for you is that the DFE is the nonlinear equalizer. The corresponding Vout versus Vin nonlinear image are the same as what we shown in the YCTOE video. Any idea why you need nonlinear equalizer? Think about a simple signal image for 5 seconds. Exactly. The obvious image is the signaling. Around a media or channel, the signaling must be analog waveform, but inside the chip, those analog signals should be converted to digital format. After CTOE, the discrete time equalizer should be straightforward to quantize the analog input to a binary format in digital, which is the nonlinear between the DL and the VL as shown here. Alright. After we understand the equalizer category of the DFE, which is the discrete time and nonlinear equalizer, let's start with a few waveform images to understand the DFE operation and how it can remove the inter-symbol interference ISI. The single shot is fitting through a lossless channel and sampled at the time TS without any ISI. Then, the multi-shot response is simply the linear combination of those single shot passes in time shift and priority scaling to the bit stream. For the multi-pass 1101 bit stream, there is no ISI at the data sample VS0, VS1, VS2, and so on. Please be advised that here we only focus on the data sample, which assume the sampling point at the middle of the bit to get the best timing margin for the data. Lastly, since there is no ISI, the data sample at the middle of the multi-shots are maximal and equal for different patterns. However, if a single shot is fitting through a rosy channel with the first post cursor ISI, and the current bit may create a non-zero value at the next bit's sample point TS1. Due to the ISI, the data sample value of the multi-shots would be minimal for the clock pattern, which is 0.5 in this example. On the other hand, the data sample value of the multi-shot would be maximal for the long-run pattern, and it is 1.5 here. Therefore, the ISI may increase the swing difference between patterns and has the worst or minimal swing in a half of the one without the ISI. To be clear, the ISI will reduce the signal sample swing or voltage margin. Then the sampler has a higher probability to make the wrong decision under the random noise. Well, how can we remove the ISI? Think about it, waveform images for 5 seconds. Yes, that's very simple. If we know there is an ISI and the first pulse cursor and the corresponding strength 0.5 and polarity, then we can simply force the first pulse cursor to be 0. After removing the ISI, the multi-shot data samples are back to maxima and equal values for different patterns, which would be exactly the same as the bitstream feeding through a lossless channel. At this point, you may have more idea why we call it Decision-Feedback Equalizer DFE. As you can see from the bar diagram, if the H1's value 0.5 was somehow determined, we can start to sample the error input x of t and make a quantized decision by the sampler, which is the output d1 here. If the decision d1 is 1, then the decision polarity and the weighting 0.5 will be feedback to the input and then cancel the first post cursor ISI value 0.5, such that the next sample will be ISI free from the current bit. Obviously, the DFE must make the right decision to cancel the ISI. If not, that will add the ISI and create propagation error, which usually might not be a big issue in a serial link. As we've known in the TX-FFE video, the discrete-time equalizer can equalize the bumpy channel frequency response better than the CTOE does, which is also the DFE's advantage. In the time domain, Rho's bumpy response will translate to discontinuity or reflection at the channel interface. As shown here, the output after a channel, the ISI or reflection, will be 3UI, 6UI, 9UI, and 12UI delay, which is not like a continuous long tail from a smooth Rho pass response. Here is the image of how the CTOE can only equalize a smooth frequency response, not a complicated or bumpy channel with discontinuities. This notch frequency response image will show you that the CTOE indeed fails in the bumpy response, and the total response is still band limit to less than 1/2 of an X-ray. Therefore, the output I image is totally crossed. If the CTOE cannot equalize the bumpy response, can we get the help from the DFE? Think about your own image for 5 seconds. Yes, according to the single shot response, if the 3rd, 6th, 9th, 12th post cursors can be removed, then the DFE can equalize the channel well. As we thought, in this case study, the eye after the channel would be crossed with a weird eye looking due to the discrete post cursor ISI. So, the discrete-time DFE can open the eye nicely at the CK's rising edge sample location. Let's talk about the crosstalk, which could be an issue due to the improper on-chip, patch, PCB design, etc. The rough image shows the near end TX could be the aggressor of the adjacent victim RX. The blue curve shows the isolation simulation and is scaled to the next ray and its second and third harmonic magnitude. For the far end TX, the output swing could be the same as the near end TX, but attached to a 30 dB loss channel. Therefore, due to the CTOE's high frequency boost and near end TX's strong high frequency crosstalk, the sampler's input signals consist of lots of interference blocking the far end signals. The inherent disadvantage of the CTOE is that it cannot differentiate the signal or the crosstalk noise, etc. Although the crosstalk image only shows that the CTOE would amplify the crosstalk, the CTOE would amplify high frequency noise as well. Therefore, even though CTOE is a must in a link, the DFE is necessary to assist the CTOE for further equalization and mitigate over-equalized CTOE scenario. As the FFE and CTOE, we like to understand how the frequency response of a DFE is here. Let's take the one-tap DFE as an example and compare it with the first-order IR filter. As you can see from the circuit images, both are the same except the slicer. Therefore, we can borrow the IR equation and plot the frequency response easily. Not surprisingly, the response is a high-pass response, which could be the inverse of the channel to equalize the channel's response. If it's a high-pass response as the FFE or CTOE, why does the DFE not have the noise or crosstalk amplification as the FFE and CTOE? Should those three have similar frequency bands to enhance the high frequency content? Think about the image for 5 seconds. Correct. We will talk about the hint. The difference is the slicer. If the slicer, comparator, sense amplifier, strong arm latch makes the right decision, it converts the input analog signals into the output digital full swing level. So, it has the noise immunity. Here is a summarized image you may have for the DFE's advantages in the equation, which will explain why you need the DFE. For example, the CTOE cannot equalize the bumpy response, which is the discrete post-cursor ISI due to the discontinuous refractions. Fortunately, the DFE's discrete time characteristic can remove those discrete post-cursors. On the other hand, the DFE's nonlinear characteristic from the slicer will benefit the high frequency noise immunity. So, the DFE will not amplify the noise or crosstalk like the CTOE does, even though the DFE has the same high pass response as other equalizers. Please be advised that this video is to show the image of why we need the DFE in the circuit system. So, all the circuit images are related to the advantage of the DFE here. Thanks for watching. Before you go, if you are benefiting from those circuit images, I would love to hear your feedback and please share your comments down below. Lastly, please share the video link with people who may benefit from it.